Welcome back to Ton Does Linux and More. I'm your host, and wow, what an absolutely massive week we've had in the Linux world. We're talking game-changing NVIDIA drivers with serious Wayland improvements, VirtualBox finally cracking the ARM code, multiple major distribution releases, and some community drama that's got everyone talking. So grab your favorite caffeinated beverage, because we've got a lot to cover in today's Linux News Roundup for the week of August 12th through 18th, 2025. Let's dive in. All right, let's kick things off with kernel news, because this week we saw some significant updates across multiple kernel branches that you absolutely need to know about. First up, we got Linux kernel 6.16.1, and folks, this isn't just your typical point release. This update brings some serious under-the-hood improvements that are going to make your system more stable and responsive. We're talking about enhanced hardware support, particularly for newer Intel and AMD processors, plus some critical security patches that address vulnerabilities discovered in the previous weeks. But here's where it gets really interesting. We also saw updates to the long-term support branches. Linux kernel 6.12.42 LTS got a substantial update, and this is huge for enterprise users and anyone running production systems. The LTS kernels are your rock-solid foundation, and seeing active development here means better stability for mission-critical deployments now. What's particularly exciting is the initial support we're seeing for Linux kernel 6.17 in various applications. VirtualBox 7.2, which we'll talk about in detail later, already has preliminary support for 6.17, which shows just how quickly the ecosystem is adapting to newer kernel versions. And speaking of security, we had some important security updates this week. Debian pushed out DSA 5973-1, which addresses several kernel vulnerabilities that could lead to privilege escalation or information leaks. Alma Linux followed suit with their ALSA 2025-13602 security advisory. The key takeaway here, if you're running Debian, Ubuntu, or any Debian-based distribution, make sure you're running those updates. These aren't the kind of security patches you want to postpone, but kernel updates are just the beginning of this week's massive news cycle. Now let's talk distributions, because this week was absolutely packed with releases that are going to change how you think about Linux in 2025. The biggest story has to be SparkyLinux 8.0, and here's why this matters more than you might think. SparkyLinux 8.0 is one of the very first distributions to ship with Debian 13 Trixie as its base, which means we're getting our first real-world look at how Debian 13 performs in a user-friendly package. What's really impressive is the variety they're offering. We're talking KDE Plasma, XFCE, LXQt, Mate, and even minimal GUI and minimal CLI editions. This gives you everything from a full-featured desktop experience down to a bare-bones system you can customize exactly how you want. But here's the thing about Debian 13 that's got everyone excited, and this is huge. For the first time ever, Debian officially RISC-V, the RISC-V 64-bit architecture. We're talking about the future of open-source hardware here, folks. RISC-V is completely open, unlike ARM or x86. And seeing Debian embrace it means we're going to see a lot more RISC-V development in the coming years. Now, there's a flip side to this story. Debian 13 has officially dropped support for 32-bit x86 and both 32-bit and 64-bit NIPS architectures. If you're still running ancient hardware, this might be the time to start planning your migration strategy. Whoa, but wait! There's more distribution news. LibreELEC 12.2 dropped this week with Kodi Omega 21.2, and if you're running a home theater PC or media center setup, this is a must-have update. The performance improvements alone make it worth the upgrade, plus you're getting all the latest codec support and streaming optimizations. Now, here's some bittersweet news. Kaizen Linux released version 3.0 this week, but they also announced that this will be their final release. The project is shutting down. Kaizen was a really solid forensics and system rescue distribution, and it's always sad to see good projects come to an end. But that's the nature of open source. Projects come and go, and the community adapts. We also saw Griml 2025.08 release, which is perfect timing since it's based on Debian Trixie, and it came out right around Debian's 32nd anniversary. If you're a system administrator or you do a lot of system recovery work, Griml is still one of the best tools in your toolkit. And speaking of anniversaries, both Debian and GNOME celebrated major milestones this week. Debian hit 32 years and GNOME celebrated 28 years. These aren't just numbers, folks. These are testaments to the staying power and community dedication that makes Linux what it is today. All right, let's dive into desktop environments and applications, because this week brought some absolutely game-changing updates that are going to improve your daily Linux experience. First up, KDE Gear 25.08 is here, and this is a massive collection of application updates that KDE users have been waiting for. We're talking about improvements across the entire KDE ecosystem, better file management in Dolphin, enhanced multimedia support in various applications, and performance optimizations that you're going to feel immediately. What I love about KDE Gear releases is that they're not just about adding new features. They're about polishing the experience. The KDE team has been laser-focused on making everything feel more responsive and intuitive, and it really shows in this release. Now, GNOME users aren't left out either. GNOME 48.4 finally, and I mean finally, improved the update notifications in GNOME software. If you've ever been frustrated by unclear or missing update notifications, this fix is going to make your life so much better. It's one of those quality of life improvements that you don't realize how much you needed until you have it. But here's the really exciting news. GNOME 49 beta is available for public testing. And it dropped right on GNOME's 28th anniversary. This beta includes some significant changes to how GNOME handles backlight control and system notifications. If you're running a laptop, the backlight improvements alone make this worth testing. Speaking of desktop improvements, Plasma 6.5 is taking shape, and the improvements to notifications and theme tweaks are looking really promising. The KDE team has been working hard on making Plasma more consistent and visually appealing, and from what we're seeing in the development builds, they're definitely succeeding. Now, let's talk about some major application updates that caught my attention this week. SyncThing 2.0 launched with a major database overhaul, and this is huge for anyone who relies on file synchronization. The new database backend is significantly faster and more reliable, especially when you're dealing with large numbers of files or complex folder structures. If you've been using SyncThing for backup or file sharing between devices, this update is going to make everything feel snappier. Wine 10.13 brought improved gaming and Windows runtime support, which means better compatibility with Windows applications and games. The Wine team continues to amaze me with how they reverse engineer Windows APIs, and this release includes support for some newer Windows features that were previously problematic. And here's something that caught my eye. Go 1.25 was released with an experimental garbage collector and a new JSON API. Now, you might be thinking, why should I care about a programming language update? Well, if you use any modern Linux applications, there's a good chance some of them are written in Go. Better garbage collection means better performance and lower memory usage across the board. For content creators, Shotcut 25.08 arrived with key fixes that address some long-standing issues with video rendering and timeline performance. If you're doing video editing on Linux, this update is definitely worth checking out. Now we get to the big one, hardware and driver news. And folks, this week brought us what might be the most significant NVIDIA driver release we've seen all year. NVIDIA 580.76.05 is here, and it's bringing some serious improvements to Wayland support that Linux users have been demanding for years. Let me break down why this matters so much. First, it added support for the FIFO-V1 Wayland protocol on Vulkan. Now, if you're not familiar with the technical details, here's what this means in practical terms. Better frame pacing, reduced input lag, and smoother gaming performance when you're running Wayland instead of X11. But that's not all. They've also fixed a critical bug that was causing GTK4 applications to crash when using the Vulkan backend on Wayland. This was a major pain point for anyone trying to run a modern Linux desktop with NVIDIA hardware. And seeing it fixed is huge! Here's something that's going to make VR enthusiasts very happy. The ARM interlocking mode feature is now enabled by default. This helps reduce stutter, especially when you're using virtual reality applications. If you've been struggling with VR performance on Linux, this driver update might be exactly what you need. They've also implemented a feature that reduces interrupt handling time for low latency display scenarios. It's disabled by default, but you can enable it with a kernel module parameter if you're doing professional video work or high refresh rate gaming where every millisecond counts. And for monitoring enthusiasts, the GPU clock reporting in NVIDIA settings, NVML, and NVIDIA SMI now shows clocks before thermal and idle slowdowns, which gives you much better insight into your GPU's actual performance characteristics. But NVIDIA wasn't the only hardware story this week. VirtualBox 7.2 is here, and this release is absolutely revolutionary for ARM users. For the first time ever, Windows on ARM hosts can run ARM-based virtual machines directly. We're talking about native ARM-on-ARM virtualization with full Windows 11 ARM guest support. What makes this even more impressive is that they've included guest additions for Windows 11 ARM with 2D and 3D graphics acceleration and shared folder support. This isn't just basic virtualization. This is a full-featured experience that's going to make ARM-based systems much more practical for development and testing. For macOS users on Apple Silicon, there's experimental 3D acceleration support via DXMT, which replaces the older DXVK on Molten VK approach that never quite worked properly. If you're running VirtualBox on a Mac with Apple Silicon, this is going to be a game changer. Linux hosts get video decoding acceleration when 3D is enabled, which means smoother multimedia playback inside virtual machines. Plus, they've added initial support for Linux kernels 6.16 and 6.17, so you're future-proofed for the latest kernel releases. And here's something that's going to make a lot of people happy. The NVMe controller emulation has moved into the open source base package. You no longer need the proprietary extension pack for NVMe support, which makes VirtualBox more accessible for everyone. Speaking of hardware, Kubuntu Focus announced their new ZR GN1 laptop, a Linux-first high-performance mobile workstation. It's always exciting to see companies designing hardware specifically for Linux users rather than just offering Linux as an afterthought. Let's talk community news, because there were some interesting developments that show how the Linux landscape is shifting. KachyOS topped DistroWatch's rankings this week, and that's actually pretty significant. KachyOS is an Arch-based distribution that focuses on performance optimization and user-friendly installation. Seeing it climb to the top of DistroWatch shows that users are really interested in distributions that prioritize performance without sacrificing usability. What makes KachyOS interesting is their approach to optimization. They're not just tweaking a few settings. They're rebuilding packages with performance-focused compiler flags and including optimized kernels. It's the kind of attention to detail that performance enthusiasts really appreciate. Now, here's some community drama that's worth discussing. The Arch user repository, the AUR, experienced some service interruptions this week. For those who don't know, the AUR is absolutely critical to the Arch ecosystem. It's where community-maintained packages live, and when it goes down, it affects thousands of Arch users. But here's the silver lining. Arch has introduced a new tool called Bump Buddy that automatically tracks and flags out-of-date packages. This is going to help maintainers keep packages current and reduce the kind of issues that can cause service problems. Speaking of community tools, Podman 5.6.0 integrated quadlets directly into its CLI, which is a big deal for container management. Quadlets are Podman's answer to Docker Compose, and having them integrated into the main CLI makes container orchestration much more streamlined. Redis 8.2 brought up to 49% more throughput, which is massive for anyone running high-performance applications or databases. Performance improvements of this magnitude don't come around very often, and they usually indicate some serious architectural improvements under the hood. And finally, let's talk about TrueNAS 25.10. While it's not released yet, the development roadmap shows some exciting features coming for open source storage enthusiasts. TrueNAS continues to be one of the best options for building your own network-attached storage system. Wow, what an absolutely packed week in the Linux world. We covered major NVIDIA driver improvements that finally make Wayland viable for more users. VirtualBox's ARM revolution that's going to change virtualization forever. Multiple distribution releases, including the first Debian 13-based distros, and some significant community developments. The big themes this week were performance, compatibility, and the continued evolution toward modern display protocols and architectures. Whether it's NVIDIA's Wayland improvements, VirtualBox's ARM support, or the various distribution updates, everything points toward a more mature and capable Linux ecosystem. If you found this roundup helpful, smash that like button and subscribe for more Linux news and tutorials. Hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our weekly updates. And let me know in the comments, which of these updates are you most excited about? Are you planning to try SparkyLinux 8.0? Will you be updating to the new NVIDIA drivers? I'm always looking for feedback on what Linux topics you want to see covered. So drop your suggestions in the comments below. Until next week, keep exploring, keep learning, and remember, the best way to master Linux is to dive in and start experimenting. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.